My name is Maaike Rosenburg. I have a design studio here based in Amsterdam. Mm-hmm. And I work on all kinds of different projects centered around the idea of combining heritage, design and new technologies. Mm-hmm. And for these projects, I build teams with different parties, with museums, with archaeologists, with scientists, but also with the Technical University in Delft, to explore the possibilities of new technologies for heritage.
So can you tell something about this project called Vindplaats Delft?
Well, it all started with my love for old objects. Mm-hmm. So more or less the design from the past. And we have a lot of these sort of glasses and vases and tables, all these old objects, and they are all stored in museums. And most of them you cannot even see, but they are all behind glass and walls. Mm-hmm. And one of these objects are 17th century glassware. So these really fragile glasses, you also see them on 17th century still life paintings. Mm-hmm. So they are really beautiful, but they were also used. So they are used to drink wine, beer and water. And I saw them in a museum and I thought they were striking beautiful, but you cannot touch them and you cannot use them, so they're also, well, they lost their soul by becoming an historical object in a museum. Mm-hmm. And I was really curious if we could use 3D scanning technology to reconstruct these old objects, and not just to make a reconstruction, but also to make a reconstruction that you could really use, so something that you can touch again and mm-hmm. Experience the way it was meant to be. Yeah. And there was a whole process of exploring this technology because it was at the time pretty new. Mm-hmm. Museums were pretty scared if it was not harming their objects. So we did all kind of tests with not so valuable objects mm-hmm. to see what would happen if you scan them. Because there were all these restrictions that you couldn't touch them, you couldn't coat them, We couldn't use that much light, so we used in the end CT scanning, mm-hmm. which is, well, we could sort of prove that it wouldn't harm them because it doesn't harm humans. Mm-hmm. So it was the best chance mm-hmm. of getting a good result and also convincing the museum to let us explore this technology.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing is, because glass actually also occurred to be one of the hardest materials to scan, because it's reflective, it's translucent. So it was also the only technology that really worked for glass. Well, while exploring this technology, we found out all kinds of interesting things that were happening. So, for example, the cracks that are in it, all the details you will get in your 3D file by scanning it. Of course, it's quite a challenge to transfer the data from a CT scanner into a 3D model, mm-hmm. which seems pretty obvious, but it isn't, because the technology is not meant for making 3D or generating 3D models. Mm-hmm. So it was a lot of post-processing to transfer this data from the scanning machine into a 3D model. Mm-hmm. And of course, in this process, you can make all kinds of choices, because it's not just a sort of fixed way of transferring data into a model. You mm-hmm. can use the raw file, you will get all kinds of slices that the scanning mm-hmm. machine uses. So, and you can, of course, polish it away, but then you also lose a lot of traces on the historical object. Mm-hmm. So in this whole process of scanning and transferring it into a model, you have all kind of choices to make mm-hmm. what you want to enhance in your final object.
Yeah. Yeah.
And of course, here are some of the results. It's also, this is not a glass object, mm-hmm. obviously. So in the 17th century itself, they already made rip-offs of really valuable, beautiful objects mm-hmm. to make them more accessible for, well, poorer people. Mm-hmm. And I did more or less the same. So from the digital file, we made 3D prints, and from the 3D prints, we made ceramic casting molds. Mm-hmm. Because ceramics is really ideal to transfer all the details, but also to make an object in an quite a big quantity, and people can use it again. Yeah, the aim was really to make an museum untouchable objects back into dishwashable, usable objects.
In this case, you worked with, or we worked with CT scanning. So do you also have experience with other kinds of 3D scanning?
Well, for every object, you have to find out the best way to digitalize it. So scanning, there are all ways of scanning to make, to transfer a physical object into digital data. And really, depending on the object, you have to choose the techniques that works best. So for example, these glass objects were really fragile, so we couldn't scan them in a more in a way that it would touch the object, for example. But because it was so translucent and reflective, we also couldn't use optic scanning methods. So that made it pretty specific. But for example, with another project we did with 17th century vases, Delftware, it was pretty reflective, so we expected we needed CT. But in the end, the Artec scanner, which uses light and a structure, gave the best result, what we actually didn't expect. So still, from what you learn from other projects, you have certain expectations which technique would fit the object best. And of course, all the restrictions around the object. But still, you have to test it to find out what really works. So for these vases, this structured light worked best, gave the best result. Also because you're really mobile, so you can bring the scanner to the object instead of bringing the object to the scanner, which is also, from another perspective, really important what you will choose for in the end. But for example, I also scanned 17th century Chinese porcelain, which I expected would have the same reflection as 17th century Dutch ceramics. But apparently the Chinese make much more shiny glaze, so it didn't work at all. So then you have to coat your object to get some result, which I didn't expect. So it's still, well, the technology is developing, but it's also still exploring what technology fits the object best.
So in your work, you speak about this notion of smart replicas. So what do you mean with smart replicas?
If you can make replicas like this of a museum object, so let it travel outside of the museum, I thought it was really interesting to also link the story or the data that's connected to the historical object to this object itself. And the idea is that you would buy a box in a store somewhere in the world, and you can open it up, download the augmented reality app, and this is still, at the time, we couldn't recognize objects itself, so it's the app will locate itself by the marker, that's the box is the marker, and this is a replica of a teacup, once made for the mayor in Amsterdam in the 17th century when he was getting married. And we know it's made in Japan, so there must have been an order that traveled all the way from Amsterdam, Cape, Batavia to Japan. And in Japan, they make the tea set, and it traveled all the way back. So it has a rich story about the connection between the East and Western culture, but also about the export of objects, but also about the starting of tea culture in the Netherlands, for example. So it's an object that connects all kinds of stories around it. And we took this as a sort of test case, how you would explore this story in a smart replica. So you would buy the box, open it at home, download the app, and then through a smartphone or a tablet, you can, by dragging a timeline, you can navigate through the whole story of this one object. So from the first idea of the mayor getting married till the reconstruction I did to reproduce it.
Yeah.
And also the story about how it got to a museum, and all the time we have no clue where it was.
Mm.
So it also shows how less we actually know about all these historical objects. But this is really a test case how this whole concept could work.
Yeah.
And to explore the possibilities of linking data to an object.
Yeah. And then, so on the one hand, we have to talk about the future, but I also want to talk about even more on the past. So what's that blue blob on the side?
This is one of the oldest recipes in the world. Mm-hmm. So there's a set of three written recipes in cuneiform, like these ones.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a almost 4,000 year old tablet. And of course, this blue thing isn't a 4,000 year old tablet.
Mm-hmm.
This is a reconstruction of this tablet. So the originals are in the Yale Babylonian collection.
Mm-hmm.
They're really fragile. For an exhibition, we wanted to use them, but we couldn't get them physically, but they could scan them.
Mm-hmm.
So they used the ARTEC, the optic light technology, to scan the original tablets. And of course, the data you can transfer to wherever you want. So we, this is a 3D print one-on-one of this tablet.
Mm-hmm.
But we did not just a one-on-one print of the tablet for in the museum and the exhibition, but we also wanted to link this really old object to present day culture.
Mm-hmm.
And for the exhibition, linking these, like the oldest source of our cooking culture to present day cooking in Holland. So it also, this whole field of prototyping technology has a lot to offer for telling really layered stories of physical objects and data linked to it.
Yeah. I think that's just a great example to hear. And I think also, so all the other projects that you have done are also a great way, a combination of this kind of digital skills and digital skill sets, an exploration of that and how that could be used for heritage and so forth. So what would be your final kind of advice for people just starting with either scanning or this kind of whole field of digital fabrication?
Explore it to its limits. So I think where you really challenging the machine, the interesting things happen. So there are all kinds of things happening you don't expect.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where it becomes interesting.
Yeah.
But it means that you try all kinds of things that maybe don't work or you expect not to work, but that will give you new knowledge and new ideas to use to really challenge the technology.
Thank you for your wonderful story.